Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evening Bags and Executions by Dorothy Howell, narrated by Em Eldridge. Chapter 1. The girl who had this job before me was murdered. That should have been my first clue. But honestly, that little chunk of info hadn't seemed like a big deal when I'd applied for the position. And the fact that I'd been hired pretty much over the phone didn't seem significant either. So I, Haley Randolph, with my worthy of a romance novel cover dark hair, my I'm enviably tall, 5'9" height, and my too bad they're mostly recessive beauty queen jeans, had accepted a position as an assistant planner at LA Affairs, the biggest, coolest event planning company in Los Angeles. I mean, geez, what else could I do? I needed a job, or really a paycheck. Plus, I owned 8 fully accessorized business suits left from a job I'd had a few weeks ago. Long story, that I absolutely had to wear somewhere. Everybody has their priorities. My life had taken a lot of hits in the last month or so, but I'm proud to say that I'd rolled with all of them. Some other person might have been knocked for a loop at losing the best job in the entire world, as I had, or been devastated beyond belief at breaking up with their totally hot boyfriend, as I had. But not me. Oh no. In fact, I was doing way better now than before those things happened. Really. My whole future had suddenly crystallized. Like when you see a to-die-for Louis Vuitton satchel in the display window and know that no matter what, you're going to buy it. And I knew exactly where my life was headed and how I was going to get there. So here I was, facing down birthday number 25 pretty soon. The dreaded hump year on the downhill slide to the my life is over, I'll never have fun again, big 3-0. And I was perfectly okay with it, I swear. That's probably because, at long last, I'd settled on the career I wanted. It didn't even bother me that it required that I finally get my bachelor's degree. The decision had come to me in a flash at 3 o'clock one morning when I was sitting alone on my couch, eating Oreos stuffed with M&Ms, dipped in fudge, and topped with chocolate chips. My own personal recipe. And watching television. I'd discovered the History Channel. Do they have interesting shows or what? And believe me, a lot of fantastic ideas can spring up during those all-night documentary marathons. I'd decided I wanted a career as a corporate buyer. I mean, geez, it seemed like a natural fit for me. I loved to shop. I had great taste in absolutely everything. And I wasn't intimidated by crowds, even on Black Friday. I'd actually been hired to work as a buyer, sort of, a few weeks ago at a fabulous company downtown. I ended up working as their corporate event planner instead. Long story. But everything had turned out okay. Kind of. That life-altering, future-defining decision made, I'd registered for 4 classes at College of the Canyons. Most of them were online, but they still counted, and was loving every one of them. Really, my life was rolling along great now. I had my totally cool apartment in Santa Clarita that was about 30 minutes north of downtown Los Angeles. It needed a little fix-up, but was still fabulous. My best friend, Marcy Hanover, and I were giving killer purse parties. Though really, I hadn't had much time lately to plan a party. I had tons of really great friends, even though I hadn't seen any of them in a while. I still had my part-time sales clerk job at Holt's Department Store. And, yeah, I only made about $8 an hour, but it was okay. And the best part of my life was that my mom and I were getting along great. I left my Honda in a parking garage off Sepulveda Boulevard in Sherman Oaks and headed for the building that would be my new home away from home. It was a gorgeous Southern California morning in September. Nearby were lots of office buildings, banks, apartment complexes, and the Sherman Oaks Galleria with terrific shops and restaurants. Showing up for the first day on the job could be intimidating for some people, but not me. Let's just say that I'd done this quite often in the last few years. I'd worked as a lifeguard, receptionist, file clerk, and 2 weeks at a pet store before moving on to a fantastic job in the accounting department of the Pike Warner Law Firm last fall. Things hadn't turned out as well as I'd hoped. There was that whole administrative leave, investigating pending thing. But I'd moved on. The one constant in my life, employment-wise, was my job at Holtz. I'd taken a part-time sales clerk job there about a year ago, and, well, there had been a few, okay, more than a few, problems. But every job had its moments, didn't it? That's where I'd met my boyfriend, Ty Cameron. He was the latest in 5 generations of his family to own and be completely obsessed with running the chain. Plus, he'd opened several boutiques he'd named Wallace, after some ancient ancestor, and had just finished negotiations for Holtz International. Ty was a way hot boyfriend. He looked fabulous in his expensive suits and drove a totally cool Porsche. Our breakup was something we decided on together, and it was for the best. Really. So I'm perfectly okay with it. Perfectly okay. Perfectly. The lobby of the building that housed LA Affairs was all glass and red marble. A lot of well-dressed men and women streamed into the elevators, carrying briefcases and messenger bags. Everybody seemingly anxious to get into their offices and start the day. I'd selected a black business suit, one of the 8 Marcy had helped me shop for a few weeks ago, for my first day on the job, and carried my Louis Vuitton satchel and day planner. Marcy had offered to come to my apartment last night and help me pick out my outfit, as a best friend would, but I'd told her not to. I'd been offered a job here at LA Affairs a few months ago, but had blown it off to go to London with Ty. After my fabulous job had ended a few weeks ago, Marcy had suggested I contact them and see if they were still interested in hiring me. And since Marcy was almost always right about things, I gave them a call. They got back to me right away with an offer. The woman in HR hadn't even asked to see my updated resume, which was a real break for me. Long story. I got out of the elevator on the 3rd floor and walked down the carpeted hallway to the double doors that had LA Affairs printed on them in gold lettering. I pushed my way inside and spotted the receptionist standing behind her desk. She jumped when she saw me.
"Oh, my!"
She waved her hands as if she were doing a jazz routine and said, "Are you ready to party?" I remembered her from when I'd been in the office a few months ago. She was probably somewhere on the high side of 40, with blonde hair sculpted into the shape of a football helmet, a little on the heavy side, and dressed in one of those tweed suits that make you look like you're wearing a carpet. She giggled and clasped her hands together.
"They make me say that."
"I'm Haley Randolph," I said. "I'm starting work here today."
"Oh, my! Well, you really are ready to party, aren't you?" she said, and laughed.
"Welcome. I'm Mindy." I saw no reason to remind her that I'd been in here a few months ago asking about the girl who'd been murdered.
"Nice to meet you," I said.
Mindy's smile faded.
"I haven't worked here long. My husband left me."
I was pretty sure she'd told me about her marital situation the last time I was here.
"He just left me," Mindy said. "Out of the blue. No warning. He just left."
"Sorry to hear that," I said.
"But I'm working here, so everything is fine," Mindy said.
"Well, not really. Everything is sort of, well, it's not fine." Jeez, what was with her? Why hadn't she gotten over her husband as quickly as I'd gotten over my breakup with Ty? Maybe I could give her some pointers later.
"Which way to HR?" I asked. Oh, my. That would be Edie's department. I'll call her, Mindy said. She eyed the telephone console on her desk that had enough buttons on it to coordinate U.S. naval operations in the Pacific. A half dozen red and yellow lights flashed frantically. Oh, Jiminy. Now let me see if I can find her, Mindy said. She picked up the handset and hit a button. Hello, Edie? This is... Oh, it's not? Are you sure? Yes, okay, I'll try. Which extension? Oh, yes, that's right. Okay. Mindy pushed another button. Hello, Edie? This is... Oh, it's not... Oh, Jiminy, are you sure? I walked away, figuring that sooner or later, I would stumble across the human resources department. A cube farm sat in the center of the room, and along the wall was a line of glassed-in offices where, presumably, LA Affairs upscale clientele and the rich and famous of Los Angeles, or their personal assistants, came to discuss upcoming parties and events. The whole place was decorated in chic, sophisticated shades of beige, cream, ecru, and white. I turned right and walked along another corridor and found a cluster of offices. All of them had little nameplates on the door. I stopped when I saw the one that read Edie Franklin, Human Resources. Through the open door, I spotted a tiny woman with super short, pale blonde hair, rocking a Michael Kors dress and accessories, sitting behind the desk. I rapped on the door, and she looked up. From the crinkles around her eyes, I figured 40 was in her rearview mirror. I'm Haley Randolph, I said. Edie's eyes widened, and she threw herself back in her chair. You're here! You actually came, she said, and scrambled to her feet. She rushed around the desk. Come in, Haley. Please sit down. I can't tell you how glad I am that you're here. Wow, I hadn't expected such a warm welcome. This job was starting out great. Edie ushered me into the chair in front of her desk. Can I get you anything? How about some coffee? Would you prefer tea? Coffee would be nice, I said. Edie leaned out the door and screamed, Kayla! She gave me a wide smile and said, This won't take a minute. Just make yourself comfortable. What the hell? A young, dark-haired woman in a YSL suit, whom I presumed was Kayla, walked through the door. This is Haley, our new assistant planner, Edie said, presenting me as if I were a Marquesa gown, only just arrived from a Milan runway show. Kayla looked at me with an I can't believe it expression and said, You're kidding. Would you get Haley a coffee, please? Edie asked, forcing a smile. Does she know about... Just get it, now! Kayla hurried away, and Edie turned back to me with her plastered-on smile firmly in place once more. Let's get you settled in, shall we? She said, and took a seat behind her desk. She pulled a large packet from her drawer and handed it to me. I knew from my extensive experience that this was my new hire info. We're starting you out as an assistant planner. I realized that when we spoke on the phone, I mentioned the senior planner position, Edie said. The senior planner position had belonged to the girl who'd been murdered a few months back. Long story. I guess I should have been irked that Edie was offering me a lower position now. But I was really okay with not taking a dead girl's job. Call me crazy. I see you moving up to senior planner in no time, Edie said. Her smile widened. No time at all, really. And that, of course, means a significant increase in your salary, plus a company car, your choice of color. Profit sharing, an assistant planner of your own, a quarterly bonus, a membership in a health club, a weekly spa visit, and a clothing allowance. Wow, this was a fantastic job, all right. I'd have to give Marcy a big thank you for insisting I apply here. Haley dashed into the office, sans coffee. Haley needs to come to the break room with me, she told Edie. I haven't finished going over her benefits, she replied. Kayla's eyes widened and she leaned forward. Immediately, Edie. Haley needs to come with me, immediately.
Oh,
Edie popped out of her chair.
Run along with Kayla if you will, Haley. I'll get back with you on benefits later today.
She shooed me out of her office, and I walked down the corridor with Kayla. We turned a corner, and I heard a door slam behind us, followed by a woman screaming at the top of her voice.
Who's that? I asked.
Kayla rolled her eyes. Vanessa Lord. She's our top event planner. Brings in all the high-dollar clients. LA affairs would be circling the drain if it weren't for her, and she knows it. The rest of us just have to put up with her.
She doesn't sound very happy, I said.
Vanessa is never happy, Kayla said. Nothing suits her, ever.
I feel sorry for the assistant planner who has to work under her, I said.
Well, actually, Kayla said, you're her new assistant.
Oh, crap.
Chapter 2. Okay, look, I realize this isn't your fault, technically, Vanessa said. But you need to resign, today. I sat across the desk from Vanessa in her immaculate office that overlooked Sepulveda Boulevard. I figured she was only a few years older than me. She had on an exquisitely styled black Armani suit. Her dark hair was in a sophisticated updo. Her makeup and nails were perfect. I couldn't find a single thing wrong with her appearance, which was really irritating. We'd met 2 minutes ago when Edie, fresh from her screaming match with Vanessa, had introduced us, then left to have her Zoloft prescription refilled, no doubt. I could easily see how Vanessa had made the decision that she didn't like me so quickly, because already, I knew I didn't like her either. I saw no need to share that revelation with her, since I really wanted to keep this job, at least long enough to wear each of my 8 fully accessorized business suits a minimum of 1 time. Collecting a paycheck would be nice too, since I'd received a troubling email from my bank a couple of days ago. Why do you think I should resign? I asked. Because I don't like you, Vanessa told me. Jeez, no wonder HR was so quick to hire me. Don't take it personally, Vanessa told me. I liked my last assistant. She quit. I want her back, but HR refuses to meet her demands. I figured those demands included providing her with a cross and an unlimited supply of garlic to sleep with. As long as you're here, HR has no incentive to rehire her, Vanessa said. She pulled a sheet of paper from her drawer and slapped it down in front of me. You can write your resignation on this. I was tempted to write something, all right. 2 choice words came to mind, but I didn't. I'm not going to resign, I told her. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. Jeez, what grade were we in? Look, I told her. I'm going to keep this job until I decide to quit, and there's nothing you can do about it. Vanessa gave me serious stink eye and pressed her lips together so tight, I thought cartoon steam might actually come out of her ears. We'll see about that, she said. Vanessa stomped out of her office and screamed, Kayla, where is Edie? Kayla! I went to my office. Kayla, who was probably hiding under a desk somewhere right now, not that I blamed her, of course, had showed me around the office complex while Vanessa had been screaming at Edie earlier. I'd gotten spoiled by having my own private office at my last job, so I was really glad to see that I had one here, even if it was right next door to Vanessa's office. It came with a neutral-colored desk, chair, credenza, and bookcase, and was accented with splashes of vibrant blues and yellows in the wall prints. I gazed out the window down Sepulveda Boulevard, hoping to spot a Starbucks, home of my all-time favorite drink on the entire planet, nearby.
I knew one was located in the Sherman Oaks Galleria, but that was about a 5-minute walk from here. I preferred something under 3, in case of an emergency. I sat down at my desk and realized the morning was flying by, and essential matters absolutely had to be taken care of. I pulled out my cell phone and made lunch plans. Luckily, Marcy had anticipated my first day on the new job and had taken off a half day from her job at a bank downtown. Is she a terrific BFF or what? We met at the Cheesecake Factory at the Galleria.
So, how's it going? Marcy asked after we sat down.
Marcy and I were a mismatched pair of friends. I'm tall and dark-haired. She's short, petite, and blonde. But that's okay, because between the two of us, we can wear absolutely anything.
Great, I said, looking over the menu. Everything's going great.
Really? She asked.
The first day on a new job can be kind of intense.
No problems, I said.
Wow, this Godiva chocolate cheesecake looks great.
So does the chocolate mousse cheesecake.
Remember that girl we went to City Walk with last year? The one who wore that dress with the stripes and the gold sandals? Marcy asked. She's having a party on Saturday. We should definitely go.
I'll think about it, I said. The waiter approached our table.
I'll have the chef salad, Marcy said.
I can't decide between the Godiva chocolate cheesecake and the chocolate mousse cheesecake, I said. Bring me both.
Sure thing, he said, and left.
One of the girls in the insurance department came by my desk this morning, asking when we can schedule a purse party, Marcy said. How about Friday night?
Maybe, I said, and gazed across the restaurant. Where's that guy with my cheesecake?
What do you think of the new Enchantress evening bag on the cover of Marie Claire this month? Marcy asked.
Isn't it awesome?
I didn't see it, I said. Marcy gave me her I'm your best friend and I'm worried look and asked, Haley, are you sure you're feeling all right?
I'm fine, perfectly fine, I said.
Marcy shook her head.
You've hardly been anywhere in weeks. And every time I mention scheduling a purse party, you don't want to talk about it. That isn't like you.
I shrugged. I just haven't felt like doing much lately.
And you haven't even noticed that gorgeous Enchantress bag, Marcy said.
It's no big deal, I said.
It is a big deal. Haley, you need to get out and have some fun.
She narrowed her eyes at me and said,
Are you sure you've really dealt with your breakup with Ty?
Dealing with a breakup could be handled in one of two ways. The first required numerous crying jags, beer, chocolate, and late-night conversations with friends, whereby everyone agreed the guy was a scumbag. He wasn't good enough for you, and they're glad you broke up. The second way called for stalking your ex and your ex's new girlfriend, spying on their every move, and telling everyone, including strangers standing next to you in checkout lines, that he was bad in bed, whether it was true or not. Just because I hadn't worked my way through either of those get-over-him processes didn't mean I wasn't, in fact, over Ty. Because I was, really.
Haley, Marcy said, you never even cried.
I had cried over the breakup. Marcy just didn't know it. The day that Ty and I had broken up, our mutual decision, he'd left my apartment where he'd been living, long story. I'd just started thinking about tidying up the place when Jack Bishop pounded on my door, demanding to be let inside, shouting that I owed him. He'd decided what he wanted, and he wanted it right then. Jack Bishop was a totally hot, gorgeous private detective I'd met at the Pike Warner Law Firm last year. We'd helped each other out with cases from time to time, but that was it. Nothing more ever went on between us. Ty was my official boyfriend, and I was a real stickler about that sort of thing. Though that day, when Jack came pounding on my door, all of that could have changed. Except that when Jack walked into my apartment, I burst out crying.
He held me and listened while I told him about the breakup, got me tissues, brought me beer, cuddled me against his chest while I sobbed some more, and carried me to my bed after I passed out on the couch. So even though Marcy didn't know all the details, I'd actually dealt with the breakup right after it happened, which was why I was perfectly all right now. "How about if I come over to your apartment tonight?" Marcy said. "We can hang out and catch up on things." "I'll think about it and text you later," I said. The waiter brought Marcy's salad and my two slices of cheesecake. I could never decide which I liked best, not even after I ate both of them. "Text me later," Marcy said, as we walked out of the restaurant. "Let me know about tonight." "I will," I said, and headed back to work. The rest of the afternoon stretched out before me with nothing to do, which was the beauty of the first day at a new job. So I settled behind my desk, enjoying the prospect of spending several leisurely hours until quitting time rolled around, doing nothing, accomplishing nothing, contributing nothing, and getting paid for it. My serenity was shattered when Vanessa barged into my office. "This is yours now," she told me, and tossed a portfolio onto my desk. "Since you think you're such a hot assistant planner, I'm turning this event over to you completely." I looked at the portfolio, then back at her. "And don't even think about asking me questions," Vanessa said. The only question that came to mind was to ask why she was always such a bitch. I decided to hold off on that one for a while. Vanessa glared at me for a few more seconds, as if actually wishing I would ask her a question, which I didn't, of course, then stormed out of my office. So much for my quiet afternoon. I opened the portfolio and saw that the event Vanessa had turned over to me was a party hosted by someone named Sheridan Adams. I flipped through the contracts and the notes in the folder. It didn't look like a huge deal to me. Most parties weren't. The only thing that caught my eye was the bakery, Lacey Cakes, that Vanessa had contracted for a specialty cake Sheridan Adams had requested. Lacey Cakes was known as the bakery to the stars, catering to celebrities, the elite of Los Angeles, and wealthy Hollywood insiders. They didn't do any advertising because they weren't interested in turning out $20 birthday cakes that could be purchased just as easily at a grocery store. Word of mouth brought them plenty of customers willing to pay thousands for a unique, custom-made cake. I knew this because my mom had ordered a cake from Lacey Cakes not long ago. Mom was a former beauty queen, really. She lived with my dad in the house I grew up in, a small mansion located in La Cañada, Flintridge, that had been left to her by my great-grandmother, along with a trust fund. Mom's experience with Lacey Cakes hadn't been great, so I decided I should visit the shop personally and make sure everything was on track for Sheridan Adams' party, whomever she was. Besides, I had to do something until it was time to go home. Plus, I had on a fabulous suit, and really, more people should have the opportunity to see me in it. I got my purse, grabbed the portfolio, and left the office. Lacey Cakes was located on Burbank Boulevard near Kester Avenue, a few blocks from Sepulveda Boulevard, in a strip mall along with a liquor store, a mail center, a nail shop, and a used bookstore. Not exactly the classiest location in Sherman Oaks, but most of their orders came in over the internet, by telephone, or from event planning companies like LA Affairs. I parked in front of the big glass display window that had Lacey Cakes painted on it, grabbed the portfolio, and left the car. A bell chimed when I walked through the door. The interior of Lacey Cakes looked better than the neighborhood suggested. There were several seating groups, with huge, overstuffed sofas and chairs, lots of dark wood, and varying shades of brown and green. Positioned around the room, a dozen exquisite, extravagant cakes for every imaginable occasion were displayed. They looked fabulous. I wanted to lay my face on each of them and eat my way down to the platter. But who wouldn't? I spent a few minutes salivating over the cakes, then headed to the curtained doorway in the back corner of the shop. "Hello?" I called. I got no response, but I figured everybody was probably elbow deep in buttercream icing and couldn't exactly come running. I waited a while longer. "Hello?" I called. "Anyone here?" Still nothing. I didn't have all day to stand around and wait, so I pushed the curtain aside and stepped into the back room. I spotted buckets and vats of colorful icing and fondant. I've watched a lot of the Food Network lately, along with stainless steel ovens, several work tables, all sorts of gadgets and gizmos stored on shelves, and an office area in the corner with a desk, computer, fax machine, and telephone. But no people. Geez, where was everybody? I walked farther into the room. I didn't see anyone. I expected the place to smell sweet. It didn't. I got a weird feeling. Then I spotted two legs sticking out from under one of the work tables. I circled around and saw a woman lying on the floor, a huge red stain covering the bib of her white apron. Dead. Chapter 3.
"I should have known,"
Detective Madison muttered when he walked into Lacey Cakes and spotted me. I'm pretty sure he wasn't glad to see me. I sure as heck wasn't thrilled at seeing him. Detective Madison and I had a long history, but not the good kind. He'd investigated several murders at which I was a casual bystander, I swear. But Madison never saw it that way. He'd tried numerous times to find me guilty of something, but never had. I don't think that helped our relationship. I hadn't seen Madison in a while, but he hadn't changed much. He had the belly of a sumo wrestler covered by a shirt with straining buttons, a tie with a gravy stain, and a sport coat his mom had probably bought for him when he'd graduated from the police academy 30-some years ago. I'd called 911 as soon as I'd found the body under the work table and waited by the front door until cops showed up in their patrol cars. Detective Madison had arrived a few minutes later. I guess it was a slow day in LA, murder-wise. But I didn't see his partner, Detective Schumann. Schumann I liked. He liked me, too. In a strictly professional way, of course. Since I had an official boyfriend, whom I am completely over now, and Schumann had a girlfriend he adored. I'd helped him out with several cases, and he'd cut me some slack all those times Detective Madison had been convinced I'd murdered someone. I gazed outside at the plain vanilla Crown Victoria that Detective Madison had rolled up in. "Where's Schumann?" I asked. Madison drew back a little, as if I'd just asked whether he was a boxers or briefs man. Ugh, gross. Then said,
"Don't go anywhere."
He pushed past me and disappeared into the workroom. I knew from experience that the investigation could take a while. I usually hid out, that is, waited, in a break room, but I hadn't seen one here, so instead I found a spot on the sofa nearest the window and sat down. I considered calling LA Affairs to let them know I'd be delayed returning to the office, but I didn't think reporting that I'd uncovered the murder of one of the company's top vendors was the best thing to do on a first day of a new job. I thought about Detective Schumann and wondered why he wasn't working with Madison today. He could have been sick, or maybe he had a doctor or dentist appointment this afternoon. Maybe he was on vacation. Another thought shot through my head. Maybe he was on his honeymoon. Oh my God, had Schumann gotten married? Not that I wouldn't be happy for him if he had, really. I'd met his girlfriend, Amanda, one evening during my shift at Holt's. They'd been dating for over a year now. The two of them had come in to buy a new stand mixer because Amanda intended to cook German food for Schumann. She was an attorney in the district attorney's office, one of those attractive, competent, smart people who was impossible to dislike. I hate it when that happens. I liked Amanda,
Schumann was crazy about her. Still, I got a kind of yucky feeling in my stomach thinking about the two of them on their honeymoon, all happy and in love. Even though I was completely over my breakup with Ty, completely over it, completely. There was a lot of commotion going on in the bakery. Cops, investigators, and techs coming and going, radio squawking, raised and whispered voices. So I occupied myself by looking out the window. A lot was going on out there too, but pretty soon my eyes glazed over, and I put the whole scene on ignore.
Miss Randolph, someone called. Miss Randolph!
Jarred back to reality. Jeez, how long had I been zoned out? I recognized Detective Madison's voice. He was standing in front of me, doing serious cop face.
Do you want to explain what happened here?
He asked, as if daring me to answer. I'd been through this several times before with Madison, as well as other homicide detectives and, oh yeah, a couple of FBI agents. Long story. So I knew the less I said, the better. For me, anyway. Still, I had absolutely nothing to do with that woman's death, whomever she was. I'd simply had the misfortune of walking in and finding her body. That was it. And no way could Madison spin it into anything more. I came by to check on a cake for one of my clients, I told him. I'm working at LA Affairs now. It's an upscale event planning company that handles high-profile events for an exclusive, elite clientele.
And they hired you?
He said, with a definite sneer in his voice. Obviously, Detective Madison had no appreciation for the totally fabulous, fully accessorized business suit I had on, which I had expertly styled with my awesome Louis Vuitton satchel. His eyes narrowed.
Since when?
Today, I said. Today is my first day.
Your very first day on a new job, and they send you out on something like this?
He asked. I saw no reason to tell Madison that I'd left the office without actually informing anyone I was leaving. He seemed to pick up on it anyway.
You did tell your new supervisor you were leaving, didn't you?
He asked. Well, actually...
So you sneaked away,
he concluded. Not exactly. Okay, maybe. Kind of.
You came here to talk to Lacey Hobbs, the dead woman, didn't you?
Madison said. I gasped. The woman lying dead in the workroom was Lacey Hobbs? Oh, crap.
Don't deny it, Miss Randolph,
Madison said.
I looked at her telephone message book. Your name was in it, followed by the word complaint.
Oh my God. I'd called Lacey because my mom had gone totally berserk over the cake she'd ordered and hated. But I couldn't tell Madison. No way was I throwing mom out in front of that bus.
You had it in for Lacey Hobbs, didn't you?
Madison said. No, of course not, I told him.
So you got yourself a job that gave you an excuse to come here and made it look like you had a legitimate reason for being here,
Madison concluded.
You did that so you could murder Lacey Hobbs.
I didn't.
No one was here. You had the entire bakery to yourself,
he said. Were those cakes sitting around the bakery real?
You knew the victim. You had a dispute with her. A well-documented dispute,
Madison said. How long had they been on display?
You sneaked away from your job, came here when no one else was around, and settled the score with her. Permanently,
he went on. Would anyone notice if I ate a chunk out of the back of each of them? Detective Madison glared at me, as if he actually expected me to confess to the murderer.
Don't leave town, he told me, and stomped away.
Like I was going somewhere. My honeymoon, maybe? I didn't have a fiancé, a serious boyfriend, not even a kind of boyfriend, because I'd broken up with my official boyfriend, which I was perfectly all right with, really. I left the bakery. I loved my apartment. I'd spent tons of money and maxed out an impressive number of credit cards to decorate it just the way I wanted. It was situated in an upscale complex in Santa Clarita, just off the 14 freeway, allowing for a quick dash to Los Angeles. As long as traffic wasn't slowed to a crawl, which could happen without rhyme or reason at most any time of the day or night. Still, I loved it there. I swung into my usual parking space and got out of my Honda. As first days went, this one hadn't been so great, but at least it was over and I was still employed. I headed for the staircase that led to my second-story apartment, pretty sure I could hear my emergency package of Oreos calling to me from my kitchen cabinet, when someone jumped out of a car parked nearby.
"Haley, hang on a minute," Marcy called. I hadn't even noticed that she was parked a few spaces down from mine. Geez, had she gotten a new car or something?
"You didn't text me," she said. "So I came over." I'd forgotten that she'd mentioned coming by my place tonight when I'd seen her at lunch. We headed up the stairs together and walked down the exterior hallway to my apartment. I opened the door and went inside.
"I checked online for the Enchantress bag," Marcy said, following me into my living room.
I looked everywhere, but... "Oh my God!" Marcy froze, her eyes widened. She rotated her head slowly, taking in the entire room, then turned to me, looking more horrified than when, a few weeks ago, a girl we knew told us she got her hair styled at one of those discount, so-called salons, and actually suggested we should do the same.
"What happened to your apartment?" Marcy asked.
I'd told her about the changes Ty had made when he lived here. Apparently, she'd forgotten. "These are the things Ty left here," I explained. "I told you, remember?"
"Yeah, but why is it like this?" she asked.
"He hasn't finished installing everything yet," I said, and placed my handbag and keys on the little table beside the door.
"What is that thing?" she asked,
pointing to what could easily have been mistaken for a partially assembled one-man tank sitting in the middle of my living room. It was surrounded by nuts, bolts, all kinds of metal parts, a thick orange extension cord, and several power tools. "It's a grill," I told her. "The Turbo 2000 Mega Grill. It's got 10 burners, 1,200 inches of grilling space, side burners, a warming oven with two settings. It's all stainless steel and has the most BTUs of any grill on the market today."
"Why is it sitting in the middle of your living room?" she asked.
"Ty hasn't finished putting it together yet," I said.
"And the television?" she asked, pointing. "Oh my God, is it bolted to your wall?"
"Ty bought it for me, after realizing my old one needed upgrading," I explained.
"Why are all those wires and cables dangling from your wall?" she asked.
"He put up the cables with duct tape because that's all he had at the time," I said. Marcy eyed the artwork that used to hang on my wall and was now stacked up beside the sofa, and the chairs that used to form an inviting group and now sat at odd angles against the wall. She waded through the mound of bubble wrap, packing paper, and brown cardboard containers piled up near my patio door.
"Why is all of this trash still here?" she asked.
"He hasn't had a chance to take it out yet," I said. Marcy pushed past me into the kitchen and pointed to the freezer Ty had purchased and filled with 500 pounds of meat.
"You haven't gotten rid of this?" she demanded.
"Well, no," I admitted. "It's full of food, and it would be wasteful to throw it out."
"Haley, what is going on with you?" Marcy asked.
Seeing my apartment through Marcy's eyes did give me a minute's pause. "Yeah, okay. I'd let things go lately. A few things were out of place, needed picking up, but it wasn't a big deal, really."
"I knew something was wrong," Marcy said, and began pacing back and forth across my kitchen.
I should have come over sooner. Nothing's wrong, I assured her. I'm fine. Everything is fine.
She stopped and whirled to face me.
Haley, don't you see what's happening here? She demanded. You've turned into a breakup zombie.
No, I haven't, I said. I'm perfectly...
Yes, you have, Marcy insisted. You're living in breakup zombie land.
I just looked at her.
Listen to me, Haley. I know what I'm talking about, she said. You haven't dealt with the breakup. You're emotionally stuck. You're walking around, going through the motions, but you're really in a breakup trance, like a zombie.
I couldn't think of anything to say.
Marcy drew in a breath and straightened her shoulders. You have to face the truth, Haley. You and Ty broke up. He's not coming back. And leaving all of this stuff in your apartment, pretending he's going to come back and fix it, is only going to keep you suspended in breakup zombie land indefinitely.
Marcy was almost always right about things. Oh my God, was she right about this? My heart started to ache. My chest felt heavy. I could hardly draw a breath. He wouldn't just leave all of this stuff here for me to clean up, I managed to say. He's coming back so we can talk about things.
It's been weeks, Haley, weeks. If he intended to come back, he would have done it by now, Marcy said.
Ty wouldn't walk away from the mess he left me with, I told her. I know him. He wouldn't do that.
Marcy looked at me for a couple of minutes, like she was judging me, trying to decide something, then said, Look, Haley, I didn't want to tell you this, but now I feel I have to. I didn't want to hear what she was about to say. It's the only way to make you see the truth, she said. I kind of liked it in breakup zombie land. You need to sit down, Marcy told me. She led me to the sofa in my living room and we sat down. She scooted to the edge and turned to face me. I saw Sarah Covington the other day, Marcy said. I hate Sarah Covington. She was the vice president of marketing for Holtz. She was pretty, smart, had her BA, wore fabulous clothes and handbags, and made tons of money, all of which were reasons to hate her. But the thing that really got to me was that she was all over Ty all the time. She was forever tweeting, calling, texting, and emailing him about every tiny, minuscule, insignificant thing that happened at Holtz. She had to see him personally about absolutely any and all aspects of her job. And she was forever interrupting our dates, phone conversations, and what little time Ty and I had together. The worst part was that Ty never realized what she was doing, hung on her every word, and allowed her to shoehorn herself into almost every part of his life. I hate her. Now, with Marcy sitting next to me wearing that brace yourself look on her face, I double hated Sarah Covington. When I saw Sarah the other day, Marcy said gently, she had on an engagement ring. Breath went out of me. I thought I might faint. Then I got mad. He's engaged already? I demanded and sprang off the sofa. To her? To that?
I don't know for sure that it's Ty. I didn't ask her, Marcy told me.
Oh my God. I kicked the pile of trash, sending bubble wrap and packing paper flying around the room.
But you know how close they are, Marcy said. So I just figured it was him.
I grabbed one of the television cables and yanked it off my wall. It was his idea, I said. I might have yelled that. I came home and he was already packed. He said he couldn't be the kind of boyfriend I wanted, but he never asked what kind of boyfriend I wanted. I'm pretty sure I yelled that.
Do you think he wanted to ask Sarah to marry him then? Marcy asked.
I thought he liked this other girl, one I introduced him to. I definitely yelled that.
I scooped up a shipping carton and heaved it across the room, then spent a few more minutes slamming power tools into the grill, jumping up and down on the extension cord, and pelting my walls with nuts and bolts. Finally, exhausted, I collapsed onto the sofa again. Marcy just sat there while I fumed, as a BFF would, then went into the kitchen and brought back 2 Coronas and a 6 frozen Snickers bars. "At least you're out of breakup zombie land now," Marcy said. Wow, Marcy was right. I felt like I'd been lost in a thick fog for weeks, like I'd been in some kind of trance. And now, finally, I was clear-headed again. I tipped up my beer and settled back on the sofa, ready to do some serious catching up with Marcy, when my cell phone rang. I had to climb over a small mountain of debris, but I caught it before it stopped ringing. I looked at the caller ID screen and saw that my mom was calling. Okay, that was weird. Why would mom be calling me? "Hi, Haley," she said when I answered. "I want to confirm that we're still having lunch together tomorrow." I was having lunch? Tomorrow? With mom? Well, huh. "Our day, as usual," she said. We had a day? When had that happened? "I'll meet you at 1:00, mom said. "At the English Garden Tea Room, just as we planned." The English Garden Tea Room? I hate that place. "We'll discuss everything then," mom said, and hung up. I stared at my phone. Oh my God, I had a usual day set up with mom? At that dreadful tea room? And now the two of us were discussing everything? When did all of this happen? Then it hit me. I must have set up all of this while I was walking around semi-comatose in breakup zombie land. Then something else hit me. If I'd committed to this, what else had I agreed to? Chapter 4. Leave it to a best friend to completely shatter your world, crush your dreams, and destroy your illusions. But hey, that's what best friends are for, right? Hearing Marcy say all those things to me last night was tough, really tough. But I needed to hear them. She was right. Marcy was almost always right. I'd been a breakup zombie. Most of the last few weeks were still a bit fuzzy to me. The thing that stood out the most in my mind was shopping. I recalled prowling the malls, stores, shops, and boutiques, whipping out my credit cards like a quick-draw gunslinger in a Wild West shootout. A memory that was reinforced this morning when I once again received a concerning email from my bank. But the important thing was that my BFF had shocked me out of my breakup trance and brought me back to reality. I was clear-headed now and completely in control of my thoughts and actions. Marcy had even taken our friendship a step further by contacting a handyman who'd done some work at her mom's house and arranging for him to put my apartment in order. I got off the elevator on the 3rd floor and walked down the hall to LA Affairs. I'd selected a gray business suit today and teamed it with a classic black and white Chanel bag.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.